So I'd like to call the meeting to order for the Department or the Board of Public Works. It is February 26, 2014. We're being recorded by Northampton Community Television. And thank you for coming. First, for your consideration, the minutes of the February 12th Board of Public Works meeting.
I didn't do them. You have to table them. I'm sorry.
I was going to say.
They have a motion to table. Item one.
To table item one.
All in favor?
Thank you.
All right, great.
I also moved to table item two.
Yeah. All right, next, under new business, contract for the DPW garage asbestos removal to ECSI in the amount of $11,800. And this money would come out of the general fund.
Move approval.
Second. We have a contract here to do asbestos removal in the DPW blinds. We had a survey done by Time Bond Engineers of pipe insulation and other caulking and that sort of thing that contains asbestos over there. So we had an inventory prepared by them, and we issued a bid package to get quotes to have that asbestos removed to the extent that we can take care of it at this point. Some of it's in some of the insulation's in poor condition and basically should be abated. I don't understand why the Barnes building asbestos was never abated. I understand a few years ago all the city buildings had asbestos abatement done. For some reason this building was never done, but in any event, we're trying to take care of it now. This would take care of just about all of the asbestos in the building. There's some old steam pipe insulation that's above the ceiling that's not sort of in the worker area that would be very difficult to get to without actually taking the ceiling down and other things that would be expensive, and probably just that will have to be abated when the barns are demolished, hopefully in my lifetime. We received 10 bids on this project, and the low bid for the contract is $11,825. The bids ranged as high as $36,905.
You done?
Yep.
I was curious, you said this had been done for all the city buildings several years ago. Who paid for the removal of the asbestos for the city buildings at that time?
I assume it was the general fund.
So I'm just saying.
It might have been a central services. I don't even know if you were here then.
I wasn't. I don't recall it.
And it was something that Rich Parcelletti had told me had been done years ago.
So, if the general fund paid for it at that time, is there any chance you could get money from the general fund this time?
I think the general fund is coming.
This is money that's actually left over from the appropriation to fix the barn's floors.
Oh, good.
What pipes are insulated in this case? Is it steam mostly, or is it water?
They're old steam pipes.
Are we going to re-insulate them?
We're not, because the steam pipes are no longer in use.
Okay. Ready to vote? All in favor of approving the contract to remove the asbestos?
Aye.
Aye.
I forgot that Doug is here. So
can
often
make a
here.
That we take item number one, old business, stormwater flood control, out of order, please. Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Well, while they're working, I'll tell you a little bit about the ordinance meeting last night. Dave Murphy asked me to just walk through first the proposed ordinance as written. Then I walked through it a second time and highlighted the changes proposed by Councilors Adams and O'Donnell. We discussed those. Then I walked through it a third time, highlighting the changes proposed by the staff. There were two changes generated a lot of discussion. To do the smaller of the two first, we have CDM going through all of the approximately 9,200 properties in the city, looking at them one at a time to clean up the aerial data for impervious surface. For example, in some cases the impervious surface seems to spill onto a neighbor's property. someone's got to take the time to figure out where the property line is and where the impervious surface stops. That sort of thing. So we're going through every single one, cross-checking against other databases. We've got about 25% of the information back, at least as a preliminary look. And it's turning out that in the small category for houses under 2,000 square feet, not as many qualify for that category as we had thought. And in fact, the small category was going to be a small number also. So we've been talking, we proposed that the residential properties be divided up such that 25% would be small, 50% medium, 25% large, which is approximately what we had, what we thought we had. Except that the break point, instead of being 2,000 square feet of impervious surface, might more accurately be 2,315 or something. So rather than trying to figure out precisely for the ordinance what that numbers should be, we just said 25, 50, 25. Just as a side note, since then, Ryan O'Donnell, the Ward 3 counselor, has asked, how about four categories, how about five categories? So Doug has recalculated a few different ways. Once you start calling it percentages, it's relatively easy to rejigger it. And as we get more information in, more accurate information, it'll be continually adjusted in the years to come so that things fall the way we intend them to fall. That was non-controversial, and there was no pushback from anyone about making that change.
So did you go from three categories to five
categories? For the moment, it's gone from three categories or organized by percentage breakdown rather than three categories or organized by specific numbers of square feet. Ryan O'Donnell is asking for at least a look at more categories.
I was just going to say in that regard, I received an email from Ryan just a few minutes ago. And because Doug has run the numbers for the different tiers that he's asked for, four tiers and five tiers, the numbers are here. Ryan's taking a look at those. He's suggesting that he may actually propose an amendment at the March 6th City Council meeting. If the board is amenable to that sort of change and wants to vote, take a vote to support some different number of tiers, four or five, that might help the process along, because the City Council may ultimately wonder how the board feels about additional tiers. So it's up to you on how you want to proceed, but procedurally it might be helpful one way or another if the board took a position on it.
Yeah, it's not a bad idea. So just to finish up, the other one is, the other amendment that generated some discussion is the one that you looked at last Monday. In the end, the ordinance committee just passed it along to the council. So that's unresolved. They passed it along with no comment. The hope is that we'll figure something out between now and March 6th that would be amenable to everybody.
Can you refresh my memory?
That's the one where they. Pardon, say it again?
Remind me what we talked about tonight.
The single paragraph on a sheet of paper.
This yes,
the
I
attempt
I
to
re-
treatment of the enterprise funds and
the I attempt to
that's
restrict.
That's all I needed. I got it.
Yeah.
Just needed a clue.
So that's still actively being discussed. Let's see if we can come up with something. And this is how I represented your discussion, which I gleaned through conversations with Chris and Jim and reading the notes. I said there were three primary points of discussion. First point was, why are we even in the middle of this? This seems like something that ought to be considered between the City Council and the Mayor's office. It doesn't feel like a technical issue that requires our input. Secondly, why is this proposed enterprise fund being treated differently than the other three? Is there something wrong with the other three? Should someone be looking at all of them? You know, how's that all fall apart? And then the third point I made is that
language.
Tell me.
The language. How it was written.
Oh, I can't believe I'm fuzzing out on this.
You felt that was, you felt, based on our conversation, you felt that it was sufficiently vague that...
political versus non-political decision?
No, it was... The third point was that surely some of these indirect charges must be legitimate. I mean, although on one hand it's easy to agree that there's opportunity for excessive charge, certainly some of them must make sense. So those are the three points that I represented you as having talked about. And I said kind of, actually this is all being repeated in an email that I was hoping to send out tonight or tomorrow. And then the language was so vague that it's hard to turn back to the ordinance as written for any guidance about those, any of those questions. Mm-hmm. So, as I say, the ordinance committee just passed it along. And they asked us from the chair to keep working on it and see if we could get it resolved. They'd like to have it resolved before the full council. Yes?
So who's on the ordinance committee?
Ryan from Ward 3, Murphy, and Maureen Carney.
Okay. So they declined to take a stance and pass it on to the city council as a
Passed it without comment.
They did.
Yeah.
They passed our recommendation without comment.
No. They passed Jesse's ordinance through without comment.
Oh, I misunderstood you.
It didn't receive our endorsement, nor did it receive comment from the ordinance committee.
Well, I think what they did is they moved every proposal except the one about indirects and pilots, and they requested that the board work with Jesse to come up with some different language and have that available for the full council when they meet. So I don't think they actually took any position on what Dave Murphy was calling item M.
Yeah.
Right? Is that right?
Yeah. So I'll have an email for you.
Item M.
That's where it would fit in the list.
Area 91.
Exactly.
Yeah. Recommendation, basically.
It's in what is Area D.
But other than that, it was, you know, it's like many of the others, fairly mild. Even the people who were speaking against it admitted that it had been a good process. It seemed fair. They were not thrilled about it, but I was pretty happy with how
yeah.
it worked out.
I thought the meeting went well.
I'm concerned about delaying our budget process. So
no, I think
I know I'm not alone on that, but I'm just saying.
We're on a good track.
Okay.
They plan to address, it's on the agenda.
Yeah.
Mary Madura sent out the agenda. It's on the agenda for March 6th for their consideration. And then on the 20th, they'd have a second crack at it.
But what
and
are they voting on?
Yeah,
that's my question.
I mean,
this is the final format.
I think they would vote once. Don't they vote twice?
They have two votes. Yes.
One on the 6th, one on the
9th. I understand that part, but I'm still saying, what's going to be different since the board declined to endorse the proposed modification? What can happen differently before March 6th?
I'll twist your arms and you'll come around. No. Actually, I hope we can come up with language that's more agreeable. Yes, Jim?
March 6th is next Thursday.
Yeah. So this may require another one of those special meetings.
You mean with us?
Maybe you do it on the phone? Aren't
no.
we allowed to?
Oh, yeah,
we can't.
Yeah,
We can't even have another meeting because
it has to be a week ahead of time.
Right.
It does?
Yeah.
Yes.
No.
Yeah,
no.
We don't have the 72
hours. Oh,
48
hours.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
And they just authorized participation by media, that you don't have to be physically present, that you can be on a conference
call. Get on our FaceTime.
It still has to be posted.
Yeah, right.
It still has to be posted and follow up.
Right.
The
right.
agenda has to be posted
right.
and
right.
all of that
so
stuff.
So 48 would put it to...
But we can do it on the phone.
You
need a physical quorum, I believe. Physical quorum.
But other people can participate media-wise. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah. What is a physical quorum?
I think it'd be four.
Four.
Okay, today's?
You could always post the meeting for next Wednesday. If it doesn't need to happen, it can be canceled. That way we're covered.
You can't.
Well, anyway, so that's, I'm sure there'll be meetings between now and early next week. And
well, I think the bigger question is, I think we're all very much committed to seeing something get passed. We've
mm-hmm.
worked too long and too hard on this for
yeah.
us to not get passed, and it makes sense to get it resolved before the details of budget time really bear down on us.
All right, so it...
Yes.
So it seems like, when does the joint committee meet next?
On the 10th.
So they're not gonna meet before this. I mean, it seems like a joint meeting for deciding how the wording is gonna be.
Well, the...
You don't seem to be worried about it, but I'm seeing...
Thus far, those meetings have been like at the Chamber of Commerce or at Etheridge's office. They've been little private meetings of this core group that includes Jesse Adams, which is why they have standing at the table, trying to craft some language to tightly restrict.
But it's not public, so they don't have to, they aren't under the same limitations that we are.
So we, you know, the meeting could be Friday afternoon or Saturday morning or whatever.
So the unresolved issues that are out there are this whole question about the indirects and why we're treating it differently than the other enterprises.
Correct.
And that seems to be the primary sort of thing that's out there that needs further negotiation.
Yes. And some of the people who are adamantly against the indirects, I have the impression that some of them thought, for example, that parts of police and fire were paid out of water and sewer. I mean, there's a lot of misinformation and misunderstanding about these administrative indirects. So this morning I met with the mayor and Susan Wright, and we walked through the administrative indirects. What exactly does the assessor do? What, there's a city council line item with a deduction. And thinking, well, surely that's crazy. Why is that? Mm-hmm. Turns out that the annual, not the tax return, but the
annual report.
No, the thing where they go through all the city's finances.
Auditor?
Yes. The annual audit is a line item under city council. And if we create a new enterprise fund, it will need to be audited.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's why there's a seemingly incomprehensible line item called City Council. It's actually for the annual audit. So she just walked through every one of them and showed what happens in this office and this office and this office. And it's inescapable. If you look at the list, and you'll see it all tomorrow, you cannot possibly argue, I don't think, that these administrative charges are bogus.
So you're very positive that by showing up and explaining all these to this ad hoc chamber meeting, you can explain away their concerns. Is that
some of
theory?
Them? Some of them. And I, yes.
Why couldn't somebody invite Jesse to go do what you did?
Jim?
Well, I think philosophically, even if they're explained, not everybody will agree with it. That they're legitimate. I think the way Terry explained it, we talked about some of those things here at the board meeting on Monday, and I think the board members felt like some of those, the auditor, that's legitimate cost. The pilot is the other component of this, in addition to the, the indirect costs.
And even the City Hall agrees that there's no reason to have a pilot here, and it would probably be nice to get rid of all of them.
I'm wondering if this harkens back to a couple of years ago where there was enterprise funds that were eventually used to acquire a backhoe. Do you remember that conversation?
Mm-hmm.
Is that sort of playing here?
Oh, yeah. I mean, it's created the fear that even today, if you look at the indirects for the sewer fund, they're about 3.6%. So it's City Hall, City Council 3.6, Auditor 3.6, Assessor 3.6, Treasurer 3.6. Well, they can't all be 3.6. Someone just went in an Excel spreadsheet. In the water, it's 5.7. Why? And Susan Wright has been ratcheting them down since we inherited them from the previous administration, and I believe Claire was also from Mary Ford's administration. There was a time when it was hard to justify. To this day, the pilot.
The indirects?
Yeah. They were higher than you would think. And to this day, the sewer enterprise fund pays a pilot of $700,000. It's on the high side. But they, you know, to wean the city off of that, they'd have to decide to make a change and do it over 5 or 10 years and just kind of zero it out eventually. So, I think I can see there are reasons for concern, too. But I'm hopeful that we could kind of figure out something that would work.
So if you have a discussion, then will you be bringing it back to the board for our vote, or what's procedurally correct?
Plan A would be that we work out something more agreeable and bring it back. Plan B is maybe we just have to move forward.
What do you mean move forward?
Without the board taking a position on the amendment.
Oh, okay.
So right now we're talking about a $2 million revenue stream. New sewer, stormwater enterprise.
Mm-hmm.
Are any of the other enterprise funds comparable to $2 million? Probably much larger.
This would be, well, not solid waste, not smaller. But.
Solid waste is very small now.
And the indirect rates on those are?
0.25% they were this year.
Solid waste is very tiny.
Yeah. So is there anything that's sort of comparable to the stormwater? Because I mean, in my mind, do the math. Because I understand where that is. I would generate an Excel spreadsheet just like the one you described.
Mm-hmm.
Because you can really get wrapped up in the, well, how much money does the assessor's office really have to spend on this? And that can make you nuts. They have to come up with some sort of like universal principle to apply. Like, okay, $2 million. What's an indirect of that? You know, if this the water fund is. No,
it's about 2% of the total budget for the city.
Yeah. That seems like, you know, you could make some comparables saying, you know, we, you know, 2% of the water enterprise fund is for indirect. You know, it seems comparable in terms of the billing of
Susan Wright would be willing to go even further and calculate it office by office. The assessor's office pays all of the, is the assessor pays all the bills?
Tax one.
No, the payroll. They generate payroll checks. They'll pay
auditor's office.
Auditor, okay, but
the bills from Tripod Audio.
Exactly, or to ECSI for this asbestos removal. So, let's say they write 10,000 checks a year. 586 checks are for the stormwater enterprise fund. Poof, you do the math, and that's the percentage of their budget that ought to come from the enterprise fund. And she says if we do that properly, the number might even go up or down, but at least you'd be able to explain the number.
Mm-hmm.
And she's required to explain the number through a policy that she writes for the determination of indirects. So the city has a policy on how these numbers are determined, and that's reviewed by the auditor. And that's in accordance with the state guidance on how enterprise funds are run.
Mm-hmm.
She's meeting tomorrow with DOR about indirects, and they're about a month away from issuing written guidelines about indirects. And for example, they have flagged the pilot for the sewer, the 700.
That's problematic.
They have questions about that.
There's always that question.
So anyway, I remain optimistic.
Okay.
You know, we're
so
chugging along.
So I'm still working on our process stuff and moving forward to so that on March 6th that there's a clear sort of ordinance that the city council is considering.
Well, the ordinance is totally done. Today, Jim or Doug married all of these amendments, which were broadly supported and were passed by the committee. Into one large document. All that's missing at this point is that one amendment that you talked about on Monday.
Oh, okay.
That's to be determined.
That's actually good.
That's the only thing left in the whole 8-9 pages. Would you agree?
But I would like to just be very clear that I'd like us to very clearly express support for the indirects. In line to be calculated in line with how the other indirects are calculated for the other enterprise funds, because I think we have history and confidence in that methodology.
Mm-hmm. Well, give me a chance to, and it'll be Jim, me and Jim, but give us a chance to see if we can come up with something that's more agreeable.
And so that's final language that council could decide on themselves.
Yes.
They really don't need, I mean, we've provided some feedback and some guidance on our thoughts about it, but.
So now it'd be input but not endorsement.
Could be. If I had been here Monday, I might have tried to move things in that direction with, you know, instead of, I believe your vote did not support it, but it didn't have any further thoughts. You know, maybe all we come up with in the end is some thoughts.
Well, I thought, I think we're, no, treat them like those, the endorsements.
Well, that could be, yeah, I mean, that would be a motion, and I haven't given up. We can work this out. So anyway, in the meeting last night.
But there might be changes on the other enterprise fund as a result of this.
Well, the mayor bristles a little bit. We don't have a vote in that. We actually have little or nothing to say about this. And that goes back to my first point, is that in a funny way, we don't really have a role in this discussion. I think it ought to be between the council and the mayor's office. And they're certainly not asking our opinion as to how the indirect should be calculated across the city. In fact, I would say he's resistant.
But I think that our role is to advocate and make sure that,
sure,
however it's being done, is that it's not an excess of burden to our operations, and that we're being good fiduciary agents, mm-hmm, for the enterprise funds themselves.
Yeah, I'm on board with that. Jim, did you have something?
Well, I was just going to add, at the end of the meeting, Maureen Carney, Councilor Carney, said that she thought it would be appropriate for the council to look at all the enterprise funds in light of the proposal that was made by Councilor Adams in terms of how indirects and pilots are charged. She felt that discussion, which falls along the line a little bit of what the board was talking about Monday, which was, why is this one different than the other ones, and should they all be looked at together? And that was a question that she asked at the end of the meeting.
Well, it sounds like the Department of Revenue is providing some guidance on that in a couple of weeks, yes?
Well, the DOR has looked at a handful of towns across the state. We happen to be one of them, but they've gone in and looked very carefully at the indirects at these, I don't know, so like a dozen cities or something. And we happen to be in this little group.
And that's what Susan Bright is meeting about tomorrow.
Yeah.
So that's additional information coming.
Yeah.
Can that, out of curiosity, can that information be shared with us?
She's waiting for the final guidelines.
No, I mean after she has her meeting and whatever. I'm
just
really curious.
I mean, it sounds like it's a, you know, a financial officer issue, that, you know, that how do you calculate indirects, and how well does that line up with the Department of Revenue guidelines?
Right.
And are there any inconsistencies with that? Or?
And how does it affect our budgets that we're making out over the next?
But because then whatever the bottom line is that we establish for the budget, then it then impacts our rate setting.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, or how much of the money we get to keep. Can't go over 2 million. Anyway, so I haven't given up. I think there is more to come. And I believe, Doug, you're here to talk about the credit manual.
Do you want to weigh in on the whole financial enterprise discussion?
We don't. We find it safer not to. So the credit manual, which Doug was pretty much the author of it, we had distributed a draft version to the board at the last meeting for you to take a peek at. The concepts in the manual, in terms of the types of credits offered and the value of those credits, were pretty much taken from input we received from the board subcommittee on the credits. Doug spent a fair amount of time putting detail into the manual to describe the credits themselves and how the system would work. So there's a great interest on the councilor's part to see more information from the DPW about what the credits would be and what the value of such credits would be. so we'd like to get, we'd like to talk about the credit policy manual, and then if the board is comfortable having, having a motion made to make the credit policy available to the counselors, for when they get together on the 6th, they'll be able to see this more detailed information. So if you'd like, if people have read it, would be happy to respond to questions, or Doug would. Or if you want us to walk through it, we can do that as well, whatever your pleasure is.
What do you think about a walkthrough? Too much? Enough?
I was thinking credits, I mean questions, but walkthrough never hurt, but so that we understand completely. I would sort of defer to Chris and whoever else is on the committee to what we want to do. But
other people, do you want to Doug to quickly walk through it, or don't speak all at once?
I don't think a walkthrough would hurt.
Why don't you set the table? It'd be awesome.
Come on up.
You can sit up here like one of the team.
Change the name.
Yes, one of that.
No, first of all, there's this new one.
Yeah, so there's a new one that has some changes that have come since the last time.
Okay.
So those are shown tracked.
Oh, they are tracked.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, in this latest.
Are they in relative?
The latest is that the date on the front page of February 26th.
Yes, I saw that. But it's mostly that I did have some questions and I wanted to make sure.
So we tried to keep it pretty simple. We took the framework that the subcommittee had worked on and just flushed it out a little further, and added application forms to give some sense of how that process would work. So we had started off actually with even more on this. We had a definition section. We had looking at others. They had almost too much information in them, so we scaled it back here, and this is what we have: simple introduction, purpose, defining what the credits and incentives are, and then we go right into the, well, actually, then on page 2, some general policies. We really couldn't get away with some general policies. There's a 50% maximum credit for any of them to add up to. Needs to be documentation. There's a credit application. We have a process where we're going to give 4 weeks to review them, and then respond by mail, and let the applicant know what happens. The credit will be applied at least 2 weeks. Let's see. Applied to the next bill. It will remain in effect for the length of time defined, and each credit has its own definition of how long that is. City maintains the right to inspect the properties. We need to be able to get on the properties, perhaps, and take a look at them. And we have the right to revoke them at any time if we find something wrong. So those are just some general policies that we want to put forward. And moving on to page 3, this is the small residential credit. We wanted to give some incentive to do things like rain gardens or replace a driveway with porous pavement pavers.
David?
I had a question on the rain garden. It would seem as though there ought to be a size in terms of gallons or cubic feet of water or something requirement. Is that something that would come under the design requirements to be set by the DPW?
Yeah, I'm realizing that's in the later section, in the BMP credits, we referred to the state manual on designing, and we probably should, in this section, also refer to the state manual.
We were erring on simplicity here. So we were, there's a basic design for a rain garden, for example. And we were saying it has to be at least 100 square feet, plain and simple. And some communities do go into a very lengthy description. You have to have this depth of soil, you have to have this volume storage in it, and this assumes, and I think if we reference the state manual, this assumes that they would build it to those specifications instead of laying it all out.
100 feet in itself doesn't seem like a substantial definition.
It's not. It's really not.
It's not. No.
It's like twice this table.
An inch thick.
10 by 10. Yes.
So I'm just going to say in general, throughout the credit policy, I had questions about the source of information.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm thinking, what about in general policies, put something relevant to the source of policies, and
right.
that way it's in the beginning and people wouldn't have, as they're going through, going, where did this come from, or why is it this number? And even though it's not, may be too convoluted, in general, the fact that it was a fact-based decision for a lot of these things, or prevailing professional policy that this is all coming from.
Right.
So that would be my suggestion.
Okay. I think that makes sense.
They should have a website too, I think.
Yeah, that we would have. I mean, it's, yeah, that makes sense. We have, there's some description in our stormwater ordinance that applies to permitting, stormwater permit.
Mm-hmm.
But that only applies to projects that are over 1 acre.
Mm-hmm.
So some of these smaller ones wouldn't apply to that. But I think if we reference the state stormwater manual as the technical guidance document, that would be
A concern I have whenever I look at this is you put in your 10 square or 100 square foot 10 by 10 1 inch deep rain garden and you're good. You save 25% for the rest of your life by just reapplying every 3 years. And I think this should expire. You get 3 years and you're done. Thank you very much. I that would be what I would argue.
I think the renewal is going to be more than just filling out a form. They're going to have to prove it's still functioning, it still exists. But it will still be doing what it's supposed to be doing after 3 years.
Which is holding back water.
Right.
And that's the functioning then.
And it goes to the sort of core concept about what it is that we're trying to do as incentives. Are we trying to get, and there are two. One, which would deal with the expiring issue, is to get people to buy in conceptually to what's going to be, you know, a new process and new procedure. The other is, how do we reduce the burden on the system? And that never ends. And so as long as the system is functional and providing that service for us, I think it's deserving of continued credit with inspection.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
But the 100 square feet isn't actually reducing the burden by 25%. I mean, in a way, it's a somewhat arbitrary credit.
Agreed. Absolutely. Agreed. And maybe 25% is too much. But to me, the concept is to get people to do things that make sense.
Right.
You know, the other question would be on a property, with the sale of property, is that credit transferable along with the property? I would say that it is, because it continues to do what we're asking it to do.
If
the new one is maintained.
Exactly. That would be the review process, and maybe you use, you know, the purchase and sale
agreement as, you know, a mechanism for that review or something along those lines. But again, you know, the good things you do don't go away. If you're going to sunset something, it's because you're doing something that's, at least to my mind, it's a one-time initiative. It's to get somebody to do something, like buying rain barrels, okay? But something like this, which is an infrastructure issue, has longevity to it. And, you know, for instance...
As long as it keeps operating.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And, I mean, you know, if you know, you're a car dealership that owns, you know, 20 acres of tarmac that now bleeds into a system of whatever that you've come up with that helps ameliorate the runoff, if you're continuing to do that, I don't understand why you would want that to go away.
Well, first of all, I kind of don't care. It's a philosophical point. Mm-hmm. You know, in the scheme of things, my focus is to make this work. So I'm going to push back a little bit, but only in kind of an intellectual discussion.
Yeah.
If, and it could be changed down the road.
Yeah.
But this is not forever.
If you look at government grants for so many things to cities and towns, the money goes away. They give you enough money to get your preschool up and running, keep it going for a while, but the money goes away. You know, the argument that the credit, it's still doing what it's intended to do, implies that it actually is reducing the runoff by 25%, which it isn't. It really is an incentive to modify your behavior. And it's not, the 25% is not related to the effect of it.
Yeah, I actually don't think that's an apt analogy, in that grant proposals are based around a certain function, by and large. Mm-hmm. I'm sure there are, you know, exceptions to that. But when you apply for a grant, whether it's from the government or a foundation, what they're asking is, what are you going to do with this money, and what exactly? Thank you. And you know this better than I do. And it's not about perpetuity. It's about getting a certain thing done. What we're talking about is a long-term change in infrastructure. And, you know, the pipes don't go away after 5 years. The swales don't go away after 5 years. Their function doesn't go away after 5 years, provided they are, you know, appropriately maintained and subject to review. Now, you know, again, I think we're in space where we don't really understand how this is all going to work. And I think Dave raises the really excellent point, which is we're going to have an opportunity to revisit this as often as we want to.
Sure.
But I don't think we should automatically sunset these things. And I agree with you. The 25% figure with regard to the monetary portion is not reflective of the quote-unquote 25% reduction.
Right.
Yeah.
I am concerned about what it's going to cost to implement the credit program. So if you have to review an application and somebody's going to save $15 a year or $20 a year or $25 a year or $30 a year, what's it going to cost an employee to review all these applications? And there might be 100, 150. Are we going to go out and inspect them too?
Doug gets.
So then you kind of want to have an application.
We're going to have a board meeting at each one.
We're going to have a $50 application fee to cover the cost of processing all that, and the homeowner's going to save $15 a year.
Right. And they may decide that the fee is not worth the effort.
Right.
And, right. You know.
Not to mention costing building a legitimate rain garden. Even if you went to Home Depot and just bought a few things, you're going to spend $100 square foot. That would be easy to do.
Okay. All right.
But I still think we should do it.
So I've got just two brief comments on it. A lot of utilities don't have small residential credits because you're dealing with a lot of paperwork and something that's kind of small.
Yeah.
Right? So there's that part of it. The other part about the 25%, there were some people in the community that had commented on, how much of a credit am I going to get on my bill? If my bill is $65, am I going to spend $500 building something to save $6 or
exactly.
whatever
right.
it is? So
right.
that came into play in some of the discussion with the 25.
So there may not be some of the application.
Yeah.
I think it's fair. I mean, because, you know, I know one person at least who's considering doing a rain garden and is holding off doing it until he finds out what the credit's going to be. He's still going to do it because he thinks it's the right thing to do. You know, he's waiting to see if he can get that $25.
Well, you can tell him it's going to be either 15, 20, 25, 30,
right.
or if he's got a big piece of property.
Right.
It could be $50
yeah.
or
$60. Okay. So are you comfortable with the 25% credit at this point with these
credits? Yes, primarily because I don't think we should go around making little changes.
Yeah, okay.
As long
I mean,
as
that,
it's
that
part
number
of the industry standard that we can document.
Yeah. The other question is, the sizes, again, we kind of pick for simplicity. There's manuals out there that go into extensive detail about how to size it, what's the size of the roof, you know, rain garden has to be sized to this.
Mm-hmm.
And that could, you know, to Terry's point, that could have more of a connection to, yes, they are actually
mm-hmm.
mitigating 25% of the impervious on their property. We could make it stronger. I think in the interest of not making this too much of an administrative burden, we made it simple at this point. So.
Okay.
Can I raise just a quick question about the construction costs?
Yeah.
Because, you know, the rain gardens, I think, are something that, you know, a homeowner could build their own rain
yeah.
garden.
Oh, yeah.
So then we're only talking about materials. We're not talking about
right.
any sort of calculation for labor.
Right.
But if you bring in a professional landscaper to do it, then you're talking about a very much more.
Right.
I just want
right.
to have clarity that we're, you know, that when we're asking for the cost of construction, if it's done by the homeowner, we're looking at materials.
Yeah.
You're going to need to document the construction costs.
But this is a credit on the amount, not on the cost. This is
for the construction of a rain garden. You have a.
It's a reduction in your bill. 25% reduction
right.
of your bill.
The bill. It has nothing to do with how much people spend.
Instead of $63, they'll go down to $48.
Yeah.
Okay. I misunderstood myself.
Yes, that's not. Yeah. So, ready to move on?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Next page, NPDES MS4 credit. This applies to the VA hospital that has its own MS4 permit, like the city does. So they're implementing a program, in theory, like what we're doing.
Why did they put down all those trees?
They are putting in a detention basin. Yeah. Voluntarily. Again, this was one that other communities offered. They really do, they have to have their own compliance for stormwater. So this is offering some reduction based on that. Not a lot.
And why is it only 1 year instead of 3?
They need to reapply every year with documentation that they're complying with their permit. So annual report.
So that's not a major review for our staff. We just
want to see that it exists.
Yeah.
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
Are they required to hire a PE to do that? Or?
No, it's reviewed by the EPA, so they can be
oh.
out of compliance.
They
okay.
have to, they have to prepare that report as part of their MS4
okay.
for the EPA. So we're just asking for something that they have to
right.
prepare for the EPA.
Okay. And to get 20%, they'd have to build two of those retention. Is it 10% for?
10% is not based on anything they've done, just that they're in compliance with
oh, okay.
their, with their
okay.
permit. That's it.
Because it mentions the 50% there, and I'm wondering what would, what other things might they do?
Oh, yeah, actually, I see what you're saying. Yeah, so the, in credits coming up, they could apply for other credits based on,
okay,
on that. But
they could educate the veterans, for example.
Right. They could. Education credits.
And we asked for the submission of the most recent annual report to EPA. Does EPA sort of write some letter of certification that you're in compliance, that should be asked for?
They, their silence is
compliance.
Is
an assumption.
Yeah.
Okay. So if the VA sent it in their annual report, the EPA looked at this and said, "This sucks." They'd
yeah.
send it. They'd actively send a letter back.
Right.
Whereas if
right.
they get it, they go, "Oh." No issue.
Yeah.
There's no. It's fine.
Sometimes they audit. They pick some entities to audit,
mm-hmm.
But not very often.
And
the new permit may have requirements. More. There is more reporting. There's more that we're going to have to do as a city. Same thing. They have to do.
Yep.
You know,
I guess my question is, since we're relying on the EPA process,
right?
When the EPA sort of pushes back and says,
yeah,
this is inadequate or you need to do more,
right,
we're not going to know that unless
no,
we're
no,
the ask for
VA
it.
Will know it, we won't know
they
it.
They have to say in that report, that they have to self-certify that they are in compliance and that they have to sign, you know, that document saying that. But EPA doesn't usually weigh back in to say, you're a little bit out of compliance, but they'll weigh in if they're alive.
And for VA, do we know what their fee is going to be? Do we have an estimate? What are we talking about in terms of dollars?
$6,000.
$24,000.
How much?
$24,000.
Okay, so this is worth $2,500 more.
Yeah. It's no luck.
Moving on to education credits. Applicable to private and public K through 12 institutions and Smith College. So they can get up to a 10% reduction in fees for doing a curriculum. Again, this is just for 1 year while they're doing it. And they'd have to reapply and tell us what they're going to do this year.
So Smith could do an engineering class on stormwater.
It would have to have a public education component. It's not just educating their students.
Okay.
It would have to be educating people, residents in Northampton. So
the idea for K through 12 for public schools is to educate the residents who
right.
theoretically will educate their parents. Smith College is a little bit different model because we would look to work with the college to come up with ways to use their resources to help educate the community
mm-hmm.
along with their students.
So and then for that, they might use engineering students to help with that, but
yep.
it's the outreach part. Okay.
Yep.
I'm going to ask that question again. If Smith College were to get a 10% reduction in fees for a period of 1 year, do we have an estimate of what the dollar value is on it?
10%
of
$62,000.
Of
$62,000? Yep.
It's on that list for if you have further questions like that, that list from that day is going to give you a general proxy of that information.
Okay.
The total value of this credit program we figured would be somewhere in the $60,000 to $80,000 range. So for the whole thing. Kind of ballpark. So you know, I might give away a million bucks or something.
Protected land credit. So this applies to forestry land, agricultural land, recreation land. Generally, the Chapter 61, A, B, and C. Actually, A, B, so that's something we can document through the assessor's office, whether they are in that status. So I already have a list from the assessor's office of what those properties are. and we would offer, these are generally undeveloped properties. We're offering a 20% reduction fees for that.
As an aside, last night the ordinance committee accepted Jesse Adams' amendment striking the exemption for permanently protected conservation and agricultural preservation. So they would fall into these categories also.
But this has to be actively sought. It's not, automatically granted.
Right. Again, duration is 1 year on this one, so.
Is there a reason the limitation is to grant it automatically?
Land can be taken on a chapter status.
Right,
but is there a, I'm sorry.
There may be some way to get the list and apply this, but we're not going to just assume that they have the chapter status each year. We need to see the list each year. Some drop out,
no.
Some buy out.
No, I understand. I just know that we sort of push back at the language in the ordinance because we said let's handle with the credits, but we should, I think we all agree that it sounds like a good idea. We want to support it. Let's handle it as simply as we can in this process.
Right.
And actually, thinking about last night, now that there's no exemption for CR and mm-hmm. agricultural preservation, that needs to be
so
woven into this line.
Yeah. So,
and maybe they could get a more long-term.
It hasn't, until the full city council takes it out, it hasn't officially come out. But
right.
when it does come out, if it does come out. The thinking is that we would add a 50% credit for APR and CR land.
And maybe with a longer time, I mean,
it's a permanent restriction.
Yeah.
So I think it would be a permanent credit, if that makes sense.
But you can buy yourself on that APR land. I mean, it's costly, but
it requires a legislative vote.
To get things out of APR?
Mm-hmm. Generally doesn't happen.
You're right. Well, I know it generally doesn't happen because you end up paying back some of the taxes.
Well, that's the chapter land, but the APR, as far as I understand it, it's the development rights are owned by the state of Massachusetts.
Right.
Oh, okay.
So you have to go to the legislature.
After
and
the
ask.
Legislature.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So I think it's permanent. That's the thinking. According to Wayne Fiden, that's.
Mm-hmm.
Considered these others are not. So does 50% sound right if that does drop out to have it in here?
Yeah.
That was what the subcommittee talked about.
Right. Okay. Next page, commonly owned undeveloped properties credit. This some extent is redundant to what was added to the ordinance, or maybe added, I should say, that there's now a part that we talked about on Monday to add in. So for these chapter land, as well as APR and CR, if they have multiple properties, they would be considered one in the ordinance. This is saying same thing for those, but we're not limiting it to just protected land. We're saying any undeveloped property that has the same owner that is adjacent would be considered one property. And we defined adjacent means properties that are contiguous or directly across or right away from each other.
Doug, I have to admit I'm just reading this for the first time, but I've been describing something different than this. I've been describing discontinuous properties. A woodlot over here, agricultural piece over there, people who own multiple parcels of open land with common ownership. So I hadn't noticed this thing about it being contiguous or directly across the right of way from each other.
We wrote the intention of writing this was to, there were a couple of things. John O'Master came to a board meeting and expressed concern about
properties that were adjacent by the, and by the same owner that would get multiple bills. Subdivisions on paper that cover multiple lots that aren't sold that exist would get multiple bills. So one of the theories behind writing it this way is that if you have separate lots that are adjacent and you could change your billing status through filing a plan at the Registry of Deeds to combine lots, then we didn't want people to have to go through those sort of hoops just to do what, just to cut their fee in half or to combine lots to get out of it. So it seemed to make some basic rational sense that if the lots are contiguous and could be combined otherwise, that they would only, we would essentially combine those and charge them on the fee. The concept of a lot here, a lot here, a lot there is what's covered under Jesse's amendment for land with restrictions.
Okay.
But
which I imagine will become part of the ordinance.
It seems like it's on its way.
Okay.
Right. So yeah, and there's nothing about contiguous
in
the ordinance. So so if it's protected, it could be anywhere. So.
Well, it doesn't have to be protected.
What's that?
It just has to be open land.
In this one. Yeah.
No, in Jesse's ordinance.
No, in Jesse's it has
it's
to be protected.
Protected. Yeah.
Yeah.
There's chapter listings.
Oh, interesting.
That define the protection of that.
But it's conceivable he didn't realize what that limitation was, and that at some point they might want to revisit it.
Right. Be a little higher in the ordinance than in this policy.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. So this next one, 2.7, Stormwater Best Management BMP credit. This is the biggest one, and has to do with larger properties, large residential, could apply to a subdivision, could apply to a commercial site. And these are properties that have put in a larger stormwater management system. And they have an active maintenance agreement with the city and have acted on that maintenance agreement and maintained the structures. And the structures have been designed and built according to a plan and calculations. And so this is, you know, more straightforward than the smaller residential because we know most of these we already know about. I'm sure we're going to get some older subdivisions coming forward saying we've been maintaining this for years and we want to get a credit and we're going to ask for proof of that. And they're going to probably have to hire an engineer to inspect it, show us if it's functioning, show us what it does, and then prove that it's been maintained. But once they get it approved, this credit we give a 5-year time frame, and then they have to reapply again. Same thing as the residential one, just a little bigger. But we're going to require annual reports saying that they are maintaining it. Mm-hmm. And at any point, if we don't get an annual report, we could revoke the credit. And we can decide how much to push this one. If they're getting it, credit, I think they have to keep submitting the reports, keep maintaining it.
So who gets the credit? The homeowners association, the individual property owners?
It would be the individual. We're not sending bills to the homeowners association, so it would be to any property that is connected to a stormwater system.
Okay, so Lane Slipper Lane, you have a stormwater system retained on up there. Yeah, 30 homes. Everybody gets a 10%.
This is one I've never seen.
The applicant would have to identify what credit they're seeking, mm-hmm. and whose bills they're looking for the credit to apply to.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, that's not a question for us. It would be a question for the applicant. Because mm-hmm. we have to be able to give a credit to a bill that we issue. So they would have a customer number or something and then identify what the circumstances are. And then ask us to review it.
So I don't have it in here yet, but I had intended on making an application form for that purpose to say, if a homeowners association has all the records, has been maintaining it, they can list all the properties that are served by that and make an application jointly for that, those credits.
And then that credit will apply to every property's stormwater fee.
Right.
Yeah, but only if they apply for it. Mm-hmm. And it seems to me, and this is actually new ground as far as I'm concerned, if you were part of an association like that had that documentation, that would be a resource for you to use as an individual to apply for the credit. And you would say, oh, and by the way, here's how I know that I qualify, because, you know,
me and all my
neighbors have been doing this, even though I didn't know it, for the last 25 years.
But it sounds like Doug is saying that the association would have to apply for the credit, and the list would identify who would get
homeowners. Yeah, I'm saying we could open it up to that process, because these are not, you know, an individual homeowner is not going to know the technical details of this. It's going to come out of the homeowners association and someone they've hired to look into this and prove that it's functioning and it's been maintained.
Okay.
And so I think it would come out of a homeowners association meeting that they would want to apply for this. If individual homeowners come to us, we're going to ask them for proof that would be proof for the whole thing anyways. So
right, I misunderstood.
We wouldn't give them credit until we had that proof. And it's going to be interesting to see what happens, because there's a lot out there that we don't know if they've been maintained. And I bet a lot of homeowners associations that don't even know they exist. It's going to bring them in and hopefully result in more maintenance in these structures, which is good.
I'm just thinking of the Garfield Avenue.
Mm-hmm.
What we do, clean it out every year and take a picture of it. Send the report to the Board of Public Works. Then that credit would apply to all of the homeowners in that homeowners association.
Yeah, it would. It would apply, and here's the tricky part about this one too, is that some of these systems don't serve that whole site, or it serves a part of that, a fraction of that site. So they need to show us what portion of that site is mitigating, prove that it's been designed right, and then, so it's a fraction of this percentage is what they're going to get. Credit. It's not going to be just you get 15%, everybody. It's going to be, you know. So for instance, Leah Toyota built a site on top of a paved site that was already there. So they expanded the pavement a little bit, and they built a detention basin behind there to mitigate what additional pavement they had built. They can't get a credit for their whole site. They can get a credit for that little bit that they mitigated.
Hmm.
The rest of the site is just directly flowing to our drainage system.
So you're saying
the homeowners association mitigates more than their own site, I suppose.
Yeah, you brought up one of the trickiest ones. I don't know how we're going to deal with it. Ice Pond is a subdivision that used an old ice pond and pond behind it to mitigate their stormwater. It was already existing, but it also mitigates the co-housing communities back there. But I don't think they used it technically I'm not sure about that one. That's going to be an interesting one, and I think they're going to be applying for a credit because they've been spending money making sure that structure works.
So last night, in response to a public comment, I explained, perhaps incorrectly, that if you did a development and were required to do some mitigation work, that didn't generate a credit. Was I incorrect on that?
Then it did not.
Would not generate a credit. Just because you followed the planning board directives.
We there had been discussion at the task force and then in the subcommittee about that. Mm-hmm. And it's our understanding the decision or the general sentiment was that if you've done it, if you've mitigated, that you would get a credit. Okay. Whether you were required to or not, you're still reducing the flow. So, which I think makes general sense. There's newer subdivisions that have systems that they have to pay to maintain, but it reduces the burden on the stormwater system in general. Mm-hmm. There's older parts of the city that have nothing, and so all the water's flowing off there. Mm-hmm. So those newer subdivisions, in many ways, should get a credit. That was the thinking, I think, behind that.
And that was a discussion that occurred regularly at the task force level, which was how are we going to treat sort of pre-existing, mm-hmm. and you were there for that, and I supported the idea that if you're doing it, it doesn't matter why you're doing it, and it has to do with the reduction of the burden,
yeah.
And but it was something that everybody, I mean, we put a lot of thought into it, so. I'm glad that that's
and
the direction
we're heading. I think there's been comments too that, you know, there's been a lot of people have spent a lot of money on these systems. And they were, you're right, they've been required to do them. But the trick is, have they been maintaining them? And
right.
This is going to help us
okay.
give
so
a little
this
leverage.
Will,
yeah, yeah. Right.
Yeah,
right.
Some incentives
yep.
to maintain them.
Yep.
Right, right.
Austin, sir. Okay, great.
So, I don't know if you want to, yeah, we're getting there. This is the,
but this is the, just two pages left.
Yeah, we're getting reforms at this point.
So, senior credit, and also low-income credit, these are, again, we're saying that people do need to apply. We're going to have a list of who has qualified for these from the assessor's office. But I think we'd like to make sure that people come in and apply.
I wonder about the senior credit and what the board thinks about making that permanent. The low income credit is tricky because your income fluctuates from year to year, but once you're 70, you're kind of 70, you know,
it's older. As opposed to, like, when you say making a permanent, avoiding a reapplying
yes.
kind of thing?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Although there's also a financial component. It's not simply that you're 70, you also have to be 70 and have be needy financially.
See, and this is
so
why
really
I wonder if we
want to
require an application.
Yes, what?
You know, I'm trying to think of the way to reduce the paperwork on this. Rather than put people through an application process, these lists exist, or this information exists. Why can't we just process the credit? That
well, we could try. I mean, maybe it's we just leave the policy as it is, but make an attempt to just get the list from the assessor's office.
Right, and I asked to see how it would work, and I got him pretty quick.
So
in paper, not electronically.
I think the only concern is if someone would pass away and they're still, I mean, how would that affect the credit aspect? So that having it have to be renewed every year, that seems like that would be relevant.
Right, I think that each year we'll get a fresh list from the assessor's office of who the owner of record is. So
right.
at some point that would change to who is the actual owner.
Right,
meaning
of 70.
Right, so the credit, if the owner changes, would definitely have would come right off.
Yeah.
When a property changes hands, we're notified here in the water and sewer because we have to change the accounts.
Right.
So when they do the closing, the attorneys have to contact us.
Mm-hmm.
So actually, we would know.
Right.
Because
right.
we would know who has
right.
the credit. It would be somewhere in Munis.
Yeah.
And at the final sale, we would know that someone else, we could see it here.
So there's a couple of those that fall through the cracks. We just dealt with one off of Ryan Road, where a daughter of a gentleman who passed away is living in the house. The water sewer bills still go to this particular individual who is deceased. They pay the bill.
There's no reason for you not to.
You're talking about $5 a year.
No, but the owner in that case is the estate, and which will change eventually.
Right. Eventually, it will.
One or two years.
The other thing is on 2.8 is the title kind of misleading because it's a qualified senior credit. Mm-hmm. Not all seniors are going to get this.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I retract my statement about not reapplying because they should. If it's financially based, those things need to be checked in.
And down the road, if we can streamline it, I mean, we could do that even without changing the policy. But. And similar for the low-income credit, I guess.
So that's the end of the credits. Then we have a couple incentives that we put in. Rain barrel, $10 incentive to purchase one. We sell the rain barrels still here, and so we would offer discount price.
It has no impact on the third fee?
No, none. This is a one-time, and you get a discount. And they just have to show that they're a customer of, or live in Northampton, resident of Northampton. And then we already offer assistance in many cases, and I think we're going to be offering assistance to people who want to build rain gardens and whatnot. So this is a way of just saying we're offering this incentive, but we're going to be out there helping people figure out how to design this. And then there's a few pages of
I don't think we have to walk through that. All right. So does anyone have any questions after this walkthrough? Any questions or comments? So where we're headed tonight is. For the board to approve releasing this, would we still call it a draft, yeah? Or preliminary, or?
It probably would be good to call it preliminary or a draft
okay.
at this point.
Okay.
But I think having the board endorsement for release to the council for the deliberations, I think would be good.
Council's been asking for it. Jesse Adams in particular has been asking for it for about a month now.
I make a motion that we
I'm just moved there. The Board of Public Works accepts the credit and incentive policy draft for storm and flood control.
Second. Any further discussion? All in favor of accepting it as it was presented?
Aye. Aye. With changes.
With the adjustments we made. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, absolutely. And also put a hard date on it.
Yeah. And we'll see, I would imagine, the final policy sometime a couple of months. But this gets it out there, people can start looking at it.
Yeah, when the councilor had added a date in the ordinance that it be finalized by July 1st,
yeah. But for example, if the ordinance goes through as it was moved last night, there'll have to be some changes to those.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. Thanks, Doug.
Yeah, great work.
And thanks, Chris, our credit man. Okay, so back to new business number 2.
Thanks, sir.
Did you want to talk about the tiers at all?
Oh, sure. Yes.
So we talked about just a minute ago, Councilor O'Donnell had suggested last evening that he was interested in considering the use of 4 or 5 tiers in lieu of the 3 tiers that have been discussed previously. Doug today worked up 2 tables that showed what the bills would be for a 4-tier scenario and a 5-tier scenario. Councilor O'Donnell may be making a proposed amendment to the full council at their meeting next Thursday relative to one of these. He seems to like the idea of more tiers than less, but
It's T-I-E-R-S, not T-E-A-R-S.
What are you talking?
It's been a long time.
The council seems to take comfort in knowing that the board supports certain aspects of the ordinance, since the ordinance originated from this body. So if you have any thoughts about the number of T-I-E-R-S and care to make a motion or some other comment about it, we can make the council aware of it for the next meeting.
I would just like to throw out the fact that you went through so many iterations, and it was hardly ever more than a $500 difference, so it's ironic that this is coming out that way.
Well, his point is not that it's going to move the numbers much, but someone with a mid-sized house might appreciate having a more refined bill that's designed for just properties in the grade.
I'm just saying.
So I guess perhaps a motion agreeing in principle that if the council would prefer more tiers, we're supportive.
Up to five.
Yeah, I think five is enough.
Yeah. So we have a motion that if the council determines that four or five tiers would be a good refinement of this, we would be supportive. Mm-hmm. Got that?
I'm not seconding it.
No? Oh, okay.
Why not?
Well, I'm waiting for us to have the discussion moment.
Oh, okay.
But don't we need the motion? Oh, no, okay, let's discuss. Yeah.
Simplicity. You know, I think that we really worked hard at trying to take a complex process and keep it simple and straightforward, and this adding another one or two levels of tiers, just, it gives you more borders to argue about. So, out of just pleading for sanity for the staff, we're going to have to deal with, well, my property, you know, it's right on the edge. Shouldn't I get like $15 less a year? Is that, it just feels like there's more, it's creating more points for argument or dispute and on the margins. And I think that for the sake of simplicity, I think that we kept on going back to that. And I think that anytime you add another additional layer of, you know, five tiers instead of three tiers, there's more complexity in calculating and proofing, and so I'm just making a plea for
simplicity.
Chris?
Well, actually, I'm going to follow my
question. Okay.
Do we have a feeling as to what the council would prefer to see?
Well, we really have only heard from Ryan O'Donnell, but he's prepared to lead the charge on this. Perhaps we don't have to do anything. The staff has created the tiers as he requested, and he right. may... decide to vote. Did he ask for our thought?
He didn't, but I said that we would talk about it at the board meeting tonight. We would present the tables when I emailed to him.
Okay, so we certainly have discussed it. It sounds like it'd be entirely feasible if the council decides that that's what they would like.
Sure, staff has no objection to it. I think the point MJ makes is accurate. You have more groups than, you know.
Yeah, you've more
got
boundaries.
You've got more boundaries. I mean, that's what,
But I don't, I mean, if this would ditch the whole fee, I would withdraw my protest. I just see the complexity of some of this stuff, and why do we keep on adding new layers of, you know,
well, this has been pulled from us. We didn't propose this.
No, I know, but I mean, it's being thrown out there now. We've been sort of, I think you did a fabulous job out of the meeting sort of describing the three tiers, and that made a lot of sense. So why now are we talking about five?
So this may fail for lack of a motion, and it's just, we've discussed it.
Well, somebody else could second it. I just think I wasn't willing.
Jim has a comment.
I don't.
Okay.
Just one.
All right, well, Doug, thanks for coming in.
So how did we act on that? Or we didn't?
Just discussed it.
Discussed it.
No action.
Everywhere.
All right. So under new business number two, we have a request for permission to occupy Pulaski Park on Thursday, July 10th.
I'm sorry. Can we sort of circle back? Because I think I heard Jim ask us.
It's not necessary.
Okay.
I'm to recover it.
Pulaski Park, July 10th, 5 to 8. The Zogchen Community in America to present two mediation dances.
Meditation
dances. I got Zogchen right, though, didn't I? That integrated movement
no
and sound. I think I did. I think I nailed
I'll
the Zogchen.
How's that figure out how to pronounce it, too?
Mobile
tool?
Is that what you were looking for?
Yes, please.
Oh, yeah.
Second.
DJ, do we have all the usual?
Yes.
This is an order, certificate of insurance, Academy of Music concurrence,
yep.
Fees are paid.
Great. All in favor of approving this request for permission to occupy?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Great. Thank you. Next is a late breaking story. We have a list of a notice of noncompliance over at the landfill.
Received a notice of noncompliance from DEP yesterday. Regarding a leachate release that occurred at the landfill in mid-January. We had a break in a leachate force main cleanout line that resulted in the release of about 34,000 gallons of leachate to the ground, not the ground surface, but the soil in the vicinity of this manhole. It was something that, when we discovered it, we dealt with it readily, fixed it, did what we need to do, reported it to DEP, outline the actions that we would take in the future to inspect these other type of manholes on a regular basis and inspect all the cleanouts that we have. So essentially what DEP has done is they issued a notice of noncompliance with certain, it describes the noncompliance and a summary of the information that we had submitted to them, and then it outlines a schedule for the city to take certain activities by certain deadlines in terms of inspection of other leachate force main manholes. So we wanted to make the board aware of this. There was no fine associated with it, but there's a notice of noncompliance with a schedule dictating certain things that we need to do. These commonly end up in the newspaper, which is why we didn't want you to read it.
Yes.
I noticed that at the end of the statement, there's something about four other places, and no one is sure where they are on the landfill?
Apparently these, leachate force main, which was built around 1989 or 1990, several of these manholes were paved over at some point a couple of decades ago. So the one where the failure occurred, the manhole was below grade and paved over. And we had, we found it through careful and smart work by public work staff, but we didn't know exactly where it was when we found it. So the references to others that have been paved over on the site.
These are internal roads within the landfill?
The ones that we don't know exactly where they are within the landfill. We have others in the right of way that we do know where they are.
Yeah, yes, Gary.
Now that you know where one of them is, these are all connected, aren't they?
By the force main.
Okay, so it's force main, meaning this is pumped. Is it pumped continuously or infrequently, or how is it? I mean, I'm just wondering if it's possible to camera the system and find out where the other ones are in that one.
Possibly.
Yeah.
We'll find them.
That's what I should do.
Okay, to cover that, Jim?
It covers it.
Next, the landfill recycling market update.
I'm sorry that Mr. Kozelski is not here tonight because I did all this research to satisfy him. I hope he's watching this on TV. Just briefly, what I wanted to say was that we did some research about the city's contract with the Springfield Materials Recovery Facility. We do, in fact, have a contract, which the city has signed a contract with them, which obligates us to bring our recyclables to Springfield. Now, Mr. Kozelski was suggesting that the market for paper sometimes can be quite lucrative, which is true. So we wanted to explore whether or not it made sense to move the paper to some other market. Sometimes the paper market for the types of materials we collect is $150 to $200 a ton. for that. At the MRF right now, we're receiving about $15 and change a ton for the material that we deliver down there. Couple things the board would be interested to know. A current contract expires on June 30th of 2015. So a little over a year from now, the contract with the MRF will expire. The proposed revenue that we would receive under the new contract is going down to $10 a ton as a base fee, plus a revenue share, which would be some modest amount more than that. It's a complicated issue. A lot of the communities that go to the Springfield MRF aren't happy with the proposed terms of the pending agreement. Some of the towns, from what Susan White tells me, are considering not signing on with the contract with Springfield. I would suggest that we explore other options as well, just to see what's happening. We're being penalized somewhat because we're a community that has dual stream materials to keep our paper separate from our bottles and cans. The new contract is being driven by larger communities like Springfield, Westfield, Ludlow, that have collection of single streams. And they mix their paper with the bottles and cans. Everything gets kind of junky, and then they bring it down there and they kind of separate it out. And the value of that stuff is not as great because you're contaminated, and therefore the value that you get back is less. So the dual stream communities like Northampton are being penalized a little bit because of the way of the single stream. So I think we should look at it to see if we have options to do things in a better way.
MJ?
What are the other dual stream communities, do you know?
yeah, I mean, all the small ones. It's the cities, the bigger cities that are going to single stream. Mm-hmm. So Westfield, Monroe, Richmond, West Springfield, Springfield, they're all going. And, you know, by tonnage of recyclables, that's the best, you know, probably the vast majority of material that they're handling in Springfield. So it makes it difficult, I think, all around for people that do dual stream.
And is there any venue for regional collaboration with others who handle their stuff like us?
It's something that we're going to try to explore. You can find a place for the paper to go. The question is, what do you do with your bottles and cans, and can you find a market for that?
Mm-hmm. But rather than Northampton going at it alone, and these other places, it might make sense for us to...
Which would be the plan. Susan knows the communities that aren't interested in signing on in Springfield, so we'll see if there's any synergy there between the communities that are looking at doing something else. Mm-hmm. Well, that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. Is Susan staying on with us longer?
What was your question?
I don't have any idea.
Well, how long is Susan staying on with us for the rest of it?
I haven't heard that she's not committed to us.
Well, I guess the question is, what are we doing with the full-time position?
Yeah, that was the question.
Yeah. And, but we were waiting for Ned to have a discussion with the mayor before we went to that discussion.
Mm-hmm.
Which he obviously hasn't had yet.
I've had conversations with the mayor.
I mean, related.
We have had conversations. He believes the part-time position is fine. He doesn't really want to fill a full-time position, given the state of affairs with this August Enterprise Fund. Right now it's working out fine for limited needs, but it doesn't address all the needs that the previous recycling person was doing in the past, where we had a lot of outreach to the community just outside these 6 or 8, 10 events that we had a year. Mm-hmm. Sitting on the MRF Advisory Board, being with the MRF Advisory Board, listening to their work, and also doing some regional work too. That's
Well, I suppose we'll see if you put it, if you formalize this and put out the request, we can see if you're applicants. But it's a lot of work for a part-time person to do, unless it's their own job, and that will not be that might be our saving grace. So I know, yeah. So we'll see.
Does she look at coordinating us and Amherst?
She doesn't.
Does Amherst do this?
No, I was wondering whether we could do joint things or do more cooperative things, since she's in kind of an ideal position.
But she's very knowledgeable.
But Rose says she's actually would prefer not to do that.
What?
A river and a community between the two of us.
That is great. All right, so Does that cover the recycling update?
Thank you for having that discussion. So are we gonna move on advertising?
I got the solid waste planner, that's what we're calling it going forward. It came back, actually, the coordinator came back as a grade 7. I hadn't seen that for the planner yet. So I'll talk to Glenda at Human Resources on that.
You trying to get higher or lower?
I don't think it's gonna be as high as it was, because Karen had a lot of involvement with the previous presenter, a lot of involvement with the gatekeepers that currently our staff, clerical staff, is dealing with.
Yep.
So there's been a full change of some of the duties in the position, so I expect it would be a lower grade position.
Okay. Great. Next is private ways. We have a, is this a...
That one. About Pulaski Park?
No, this is Pulaski Park.
Yes, so was that the one, the informational?
Oh, I've already crossed it off. I'm sorry. Pulaski Park. Well, I was getting evidence.
Well, he thought it was occupied Pulaski.
Jim, I'm sure, has. I know she. I know he does.
So, update quickly on this. I had a discussion with Stephen Stinson Associates about their concept for meeting schedules. They have 3 meetings in their contract to help us with the Pulaski Park redesign. I took a portion of their email and printed it out on this document, which I left in your pile on your table there. The basic idea is to have all meetings held on a downtown location as widely advertised as possible in terms of notifying people that would be interested in the park redesign. And the bullets sort of list what their approach is. I need to work with somebody to help me find spots downtown to see if these are dates that are going to work. April 3rd is when they were looking at starting, with a second meeting on April 24th and the third meeting for the final site plan presentation on May 22nd. So the schedule we think is pretty good. It'll give us a month or so to start getting the word out about the meetings. So I just wanted to make the board aware of the fact that the project was starting to move forward.
Presumably this will be held at the senior center?
It's possible. That would be a great room.
Big venue for
it. It would be a good location if we can secure the space.
Yeah.
I like your idea of the eighth gallery as well, but there's no seating opportunities there.
They have chairs and tables. Wayne Biden said so that they get booked up pretty early, and he says it's difficult to get access to the space.
Yeah.
But the mayor, I did talk to the mayor about this, and he's on board with it and is very interested in obviously keeping it in the downtown meeting space, mm-hmm. and making sure that we advertise things as wide and far as we can. Mm-hmm.
We have a beautiful new police station that has a lovely meeting room.
That's true.
We do.
That's true.
We do, in fact.
It's good size. Yeah. Yeah. It's not as big as the senior center. It's about half the size of that, but and it's got the built-in projector sheet. And if the crowd gets unruly, there's lockup.
All right. Jim, is there anything else?
Nope.
That's it. Quarter and third.
Now we can talk about private ways.
So one thing that's changed on private ways, we've actually moved 7 more for a total of 19 to the city solicitor. Completed plans and descriptions for his review. I have not heard anything back from Alan on when he is planning to start the order of takings on these properties. But we're going through the process. We actually just finished up Bradford Street Extension, Bradford Street North, Bradford Street South, Franklin Court, Greeley Avenue, Prospect Court, and Tyler Court have moved through. So we're getting there. We've spent about $22,000 so far of the total $100,000 appropriations, just so you're aware, on survey services. I haven't seen any of the legal bills.
I have talked to Alan, and he tells me that action is imminent.
Yeah.
So. Next, we have the DPW budget.
I've been meeting with staff, including for solid waste, water, sewer, enterprise. I've sat down with Anne Marie. We've gone through a lot of numbers on the O&M. Today, I went through the water budget going forward. And looking at some longer range projections that we'll be bringing to the board for reservoir work maybe in FY 16 through 18, about $6 million worth of work, and how we might fund that going forward. So those are some of the bigger questions, is long-range planning versus just the capital needs of this coming year. We do have some large increases in capital for this year with waterline replacement. We have four projects that are ongoing to the tune of about $1.5 million worth of work. So Amory will be presenting different ways of funding that, whether it's from the stabilization account or we actually do a bond because of the $6 million we're looking at doing in potentially FY 16 through 18 on the reservoirs. So just so you're aware of that. Tomorrow I'm supposed to be going through solid waste and sewer with her, or wastewater treatment. And hopefully, once we get the direct indirects from downtown, we'll be able to really go through the budgets probably sometime in early to mid-March. And we wrap up our budget process and get it to the mayor by the end of March is the goal.
So a thought that I have is that it might be good for the projects that you're talking about. By the time we see the budget, they're kind of cooked into the budget.
Mm-hmm.
I'm talking about the large discretionary projects. And we've implied to the city council that we're going to be attentive to not ganging a bunch of large projects across water, sewer, stormwater perhaps, to be simultaneous, but rather to organize them. Mm-hmm. So it's, and I wonder if the board could have a chance to see those potentially moving pieces.
Sure.
In advance. What happened last year, what has happened in years past, is by the time we really see them, it's the budget's kind of been built around it. Mm-hmm. And sometimes I felt like, well, man, I wish we had a chance to talk about.
So what you're envisioning is sort of like by a calendar date, different projects that would be happening.
Mm-hmm.
So you could see that they're undulating and with respect to each other.
Yeah.
And not over.
Yeah, we'd be talking about years.
Yeah.
FY 15,
yeah.
FY 16,
yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
The other thing is that we just received the draft and alternative analysis report from Kleinfelder on the wastewater side, and a lot of it is on the wastewater treatment plant. I blazed through it, but I think they identified potentially $60+ million worth of improvements in the.
Right. So, for example, we wouldn't want to do the $60 million in the same year as the $6 million in the.
Right,
waters.
Exactly.
That's all I'm saying.
But there are some pressing needs at the wastewater facility that need to be done too, especially in the sludge thickener building, rebuilding some pumps and working there. That has got a value to it too. That we. There's some work that has to be done. There's other work that can be put off. But so why don't I put those thoughts together and get together earlier than those budget hearings.
Okay.
Okay?
Is Kleinfelder going to give us some strategic thoughts about, like, could we tackle the sludge thickener in a manner that would fit in with, can we do the $60 million worth of work in pieces, like just work over here?
They are. Some of them can be in pieces.
Okay.
Like some of it is sewer line work. It's not all just wastewater work.
I'm thinking about the treatment plant.
Yeah, but there's some certain things that can be done at separate times.
The $60 million is broken up into a variety of projects that you could look at, how it makes sense to marry some of them, if there's some cost savings to do some of them together, or if it makes sense to separate some of them.
Okay.
We have to retrofit what we have, so, you know, under an ideal condition, we'd just love to build a new plant somewhere and not have to deal with all the coordination issues of keeping the existing plant running.
But while the other stuff.
Of course, we don't have that option.
Okay. So we're going to look at the big pieces. I believe that's it, Garen. Is there anything you wanted to talk about?
I was on King Street today and I noticed there's a really huge pile of snow in the old Honda parking lot. Some of it looks like it was put there recently. As recently as the moment when I'm looking at it as the trucks were dumping. I didn't know. So we're picking downtown during the day.
We are actually picking the other night and the equipment broke down, so we ended up picking during the day. We were supposed to be off the street, but since we were working on broken equipment on the side of the grader broke down, and left a windrow piled on Market Street, which kind of effectively closed on Market Street during commuting traffic, so. Yes.
The bridge closed.
So anyways, we did clear downtown and a number of streets. Obviously, you probably read the paper and some of the.
Did you see Jim Gosto's letter?
Yes.
Great letter. Is it, is that correct? 41 street employees in 79, 13 now?
I don't have the history from 79 that Jim has, but I know how many we have now.
It's 13?
It's all 11 in the streets itself. But you also have, you mean, you have the highway division that has parks and cemetery, has sewer and drain, has streets, has equipment maintenance. The streets is a very small pool of those people. Typically, those are the ones that are going out picking at night. That's streets-related work. If they need additional resources, they'll call in, you know, parks and cemetery around the highway division, and then from there, they pull in enterprise people to come in on overtime to help out if the job gets that big.
But Jim's letter.
It's pretty accurate.
41 to 13?
That's pretty accurate. We're a very small department in the streets.
Yes.
I also went far enough down King Street to notice that two new car dealerships have opened. And it occurred to me that at some point that storage location for snow is probably going to go away since it's not city property. And I just wondered, what would we do? That's a lot. It's a big pile.
It's a lot of snow. I've actually drafted a letter to Construction Services. I haven't sent it out yet. Right down the street here. That's a facility that we used to use until we went to the state hospital grounds. As the state hospital got developed now, we were able to use the Leah Honda lot, or former Leah Honda lot, free of charge. Very convenient for us, but at some point, it's going to be sold. I think it's going to be years in litigation, what's going on down there.
Yeah.
And our relationship with Don Lee is, I think, pretty good. That will continue our current arrangement for a few more years anyways. Mm.
We could block the bike path under the dry bridge like we used to do.
I think we'd just pack it into the bridge.
Yeah.
Just close Market Street. Okay. Whatever, is that Market? Is that Market? No, that's North.
North.
Beginning of North, right? Just pile it in there about 12 feet high is what it is right now up there. That's a big pile of snow.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's half the lot is full.
Chris, half over.
Chris, any?
Nope.
One thing, thank you on your reappointments to City Council for Rosemary, MJ, and Mike Parsons until March of 2016. Members of the Board of Public Works, thank you. There's a letter in your package tonight sent out today to FEMA regarding the application of the River Road retaining wall. For those who haven't read it, basically our hazard mitigation plan expires today. They're in the process of obligating that project, a $1.6 million project, and they can't obligate it without a current plan. So talking with Rich Verillo from FEMA, he asked that I write this extraordinary circumstances request letter to, they can obligate the money, but we have to have a written plan approved by City Council in place within a year. I talked to the mayor and Wayne Fighting about that. They both said that will be done. So hopefully we'll see that obligation. And I was told today that they obligated the money for the Roberts Meadow Brook slope stabilization project. So we'll be receiving that $350,000 or so, $375,000 from FEMA for reimbursements for that project.
But we're not going to receive the money until we first spend our own.
That's right. It's a contract.
Yeah.
So we have to spend our own and some reimbursement up to 475% of the value.
And
so that's great. That's
Roberts Meadow would be Water Enterprise.
That's correct.
The Mill River might be the Stormwater
Enterprise. No, actually, that was already done by appropriation through Capital Improvements FY14 plan.
Okay.
Is where that $400,000 came from. When they bond that, they might look for the Stormwater Utility to pay for it, though. Just so you're aware of that. That's all I have.
Okay, great, Jim.
I forwarded an email to the board members regarding a public records request we had from an organization called Massachusetts Forest Watch. They are seeking information regarding land management activities that we're doing in the watersheds. So I just wanted to make you aware of it. Newspapers were covered on this, and it may result in a story or something in the press, so we didn't want you to read about it in the paper, but make you aware of the fact that someone is interested and concerned about logging activity and the things that are going on right now.
So was that our logging that prompted that letter?
I have no way of knowing for sure, but I suspect. I mean, we do have, we're logging out there. And there's a big pile of, there's a pile of logs by the road, so.
What did the Mass website have to say about it? I mean, we're not trying to justify it by saying it's making a healthier forest. We're logging it for money.
Actually, we're not logging it for money.
It's no longer the source of funds for land purchases?
It is, but that's not why we do it.
It would be good for students.
Well, the emails, read the emails.
Yeah,
seem to debunk that.
Yeah. I didn't read it all.
No, his email thinks that we're doing it to create a revenue source. And our forest stewardship plans are saying that we're doing it to make the forest healthier.
So we're going to donate the money to
for watership protection. No, we're drafting a letter to respond to this, and we acknowledge in the letter that cutting trees down is a source of revenue. But that's not the goal of the forest stewardship plans.
But he's debunking. He made it sound like he was debunking any of the reasons for forest stewardship.
That's correct.
Yeah.
But I mean, all over the place. Whether it's helping the forest or this or he had like four or five different reasons. It seemed like his purpose was like, you cannot ever cut wood.
Right. That is correct.
But that just logically didn't make sense to me.
That's why we wanted to make the board aware of it. I think Mass Forest Watch was quite vocal in criticizing the state for cutting of trees on state forest land. And I think part of this is obviously not what I'm an engineer, I'm not a forester, but the state went through a whole forest visioning futures process 3 or 4 years ago where they stopped all logging operations on state land for a period of time, and they went through a whole process across the state. They had a number of meetings, sought public input about what their plans were for managing state forest land and other land that DCR is responsible for managing. And they basically, I think because of criticism like this, they went through a whole lengthy process. It took them 2 or 3 years to develop management plans. They have different management plans for different state forests, for different pieces of land, to get public input and finalize those plans and widely publicize what they were doing and what their intention was in regard to land management so that people knew. And I think part of the problem appeared to be the fact that the state was doing a lot of things that just they didn't communicate to the public very well what their intentions were, what their goals were. So there was a lot of press. I don't know if you remember this, 2 or 3 years ago in the Globe and even in the local newspapers, there was a lot about cutting trees at Quadern Reservoir, for example.
That's what I remember, the Quadern. Mm-hmm.
So he's a concerned citizen who happens to be on the board of this forest watch.
I don't know anything about this organization. Other than they have a website and this person is associated with it. I don't know if it's him or 100 people or...
They certainly have no oversight role as far as what we do.
Right. So the letter went to Public Works, the mayor, a couple of newspapers, Councilor Spector and Representative Cocott. We drafted a response which we'll send out. We'll send it to the mayor and Council Inspector and to Representative Cocott, just so they can see the information that was requested in kind of summary format.
And we'll get a copy of
that. And am I correct? We have a written plan, which is practically a model.
We do. We've posted a lot of our watershed activities on the Public Works website. Forest stewardship plans, cutting plans, other watershed-related activities are on our website as well, so you can find information there. That's it.
Thanks. BJ?
I'm all set.
Good. MJ?
Okay. Okay.
DJ?
I'm good too.
All right, I'm fine.
Okay. Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.